Me true, and no matter what they do, and no matter what me true,
I'm playing for you, Andrew.
Even fire is burning and melting the coals. It's going destroying the souls. Oh, that, and going to make a speech. Then it's too late. Burning, but we can't go.
I was 5 years old. Okay. And after that, I did excavation work before the freedom of Tanganyika with Mr. Neville Chittick, a man from England. That was before Dr. Leake. You know, Dr. Leake, when he came in 1959, he was posted to Arusha Olduvai Gorge to discover the Zinja Thropas. I worked with him together. So I'm lucky to see certain people here. So we say Bagamoyo, it means that you are welcome. Bagamoyo, it means that forget where I come from, don't think home again. This is meaning of Bagamoyo.
Okay.
So if you are here, don't think home. Feel as you are at home.
Okay.
So our timetable is we are going to start to see where the first settlement of Bagamoyo. We push up, we explain about that, and then we come, I'll show you slaves' house where slaves have been kept. And then from that, we come and see where the first German state house, which was built in Tanganyika before to move the headquarters to Dar es Salaam. That was built in 1897. And from there, we will go and see where the name of Bagamoyo was born at Caravanserai House. Then from there, straight we go to see the museum. All this, what I'm explaining you, is well preserved in the Roman Catholic Museum there. See, after that, we come back to see your ranch. I allow many questions. Who wants to ask me, you are welcome to
Let
ask
me start with this. You witnessed the first eclipse of the sun here in 1940.
I've been born in 1940.
47?
No, 1940.
Okay.
Don't fall inside, though.
Just normal well. It's normal well, oh.
Now, attention please. Now we start our history here.
Right.
Yeah. First of all, the name of this place here is known as Pumbuji. Although now we have come at the Kaore ruins. But the first name in olden time it was known here as Pumbuji.
Pumbuji.
Yes, sir. So the settlement started from 13th century from the patients.
What's the spelling of that? What is the spelling of that?
Pumbuji settlement.
It was the first settlement. By the Arab from patients, the Shirazi Arabs. But once they arrived here, they started to dig a well and just to get water. And this is the oldest. It was dug in 1270. And it's still water in it. And no salt and never dry.
The Shirazi Arabs.
But once they arrived here, the first thing they started to dig a well in case to get water. And it still there's water. No salt and never dry. I used to drink this water for more than 20 years. Even now, I've drunk the water in front of you. After that, though, the Arabs, when they arrived here, they were Muslims. The first thing they started to dig, to build a mosque. This is a mosque. But according to Muslims' habit, they must wash before they go to pray. So they fill this water behind of this wall here to wash the face and hands. And then they fill this water again here. They wash for that. See, the whole place here, as you can see, it was covered with the sand. So we did excavation in 1958 before the freedom of Tanganyika with Mr. Neville Chittick, a man from England. That was before Dr. Leakey to come to Tanganyika in 1959. I did excavated myself before with the men. So we have repaired that a piece of wood on a door plus a piece of iron to support that wall not to fall down. And those are broken pieces of the roof. But how did it was held by the mangrove trees. You can see signs here. Here, to bend the coral reefs, which they get them from the sea, and then the lime of this they mix together with the sand, and then they dig a pitch and bury it and leave it to stay for a while. And then when they did excavation the place again and squeeze the mud with water, there comes carbon dioxide from the lime of the coral reefs. So the whole mud becomes lime cement, very strong. That is the end of the mosque.
Okay.
Now we are in a graveyard. Those are graves of those Arabs who started the settlement here.
Okay.
But those graves with the pillars, plus this one, which is broken, the pieces here inside, you can see it.
Yes.
That was the first people to be buried here in 1207. And the other graves are from that period up to 18th century. Then this side, come. Big science, here you are. But you start right to go left. Sheikh is a promotion of the man who was buried. Ali ibn Juma, his name. It's Ali Sani of Juma. This is Hamso Khamsin. It means that he died while he was 55 years old and was buried here in 1270. So it shows that those graves with the pillars were the first people to be buried here in 13th century.
He died in what year?
There were five Chinese porcelains on the pillar. But three of them in 1958, when we excavated here, it was in open place. So it was stolen by bad people. But two Chinese porcelain. Some of them, we sent them in the King George Museum in the Lestrum to be preserved. So it shows that those Arabs in 13th centuries, they were trading with Chinese people to exchange the value things instead of money. It's like barter trading. And many visitors who are visiting here, they would like to see those Chinese porcelains here, not in Dar es Salaam. So the Department of Antiquities have prepared a house, and all what was in Dar es Salaam brought back again here. We've got a museum. Whenever you finish your tour, you can go and see which people. Now you can't read because of this moss started to grow in a coral reefs. But the first stone down here, it says that the Arabs is said from 13th century up to 18th when they hand over the government to German. Because they didn't fight with our country. There was an agreement between those two people. And the last stone on top, it says that all these are family graves of this Sheikh Ali Sani of Juma. Because the behind the grave plus those two here for his sisters and the big one here with the pillar, his wife. The first big pillar with a pillar there, his father, the last one his mother, and another grave with a pillar but broken his grandfather. So all those are family graves of this is Sheikh Ali Sani of Juma, who started the settlement here. Her name is Hadija. It has been written on a stone. Come and see.
Hello.
woman's was stolen together with the Chinese porcelain.
Okay, so they never knew the man's name.
There was the name of a man here, but it's stolen because it was in a film of Chinese porcelain.
The
Is he coming to now?
No, look. How they who brought the money there? Because how they do, you kneel here, you take the sand, you make a wish, whatever you like, and then off you go. But if you got donation, you put it because of the buying the incense and the sticks, you see. So if in another day if you come to say thank you, they prepare fire, they take the check off. Through this port here, then they burn incense, they keep inside in the grave to make the grave to smell well, that is to thank.
Who spent the money? The people who came, who come?
No, why are you asking this kind of question?
Your question, who is taking the money?
Yes.
See, we give for those children no father, no mother.
Okay.
See, and they are sometimes in the churches or mission, in mosque, if no oil for lamp, they take it, they burn it.
What is the minimum that you can pay? Because I can see that...
They do what you wanted.
Yeah.
But you forget it to celebrate it. Because you promise here, when I succeed, I'll do something else.
You have instant dreams.
Prof. Between his empire. So even here where we are, it was under the Sultan of Zanzibar. So you can't do anything unless you get a permit from the Sultan of Zanzibar. And when the Sultan was in Zanzibar, he brought some Kurdish people to start to guard the 10 miles strip under the Sultan of Zanzibar. So at the village where we passed through before that, there was no houses. It was only forest. They made houses for Baruchi soldiers to stay, and the slaves, they were staying with those Baruchi soldiers in their houses, and some Arabs came to make a settlement. So from that time, the name of Kaole was born. Today, we've come with the Kaole ruins. What the Kaole means? Kaole, it means that you go and see how the Arab did. This was named by the owner Bagamoyo are 4 tribals. You get Zalambo by tribal, Loi by tribal, Gore by tribal, and Zigua people. So to all together, all of them, they admired how the people came there, white people and the slaves. So the local people were informing one another in their language that Kalole Malabu Watendide, Wame Mandu, it means that you go and see how they loved it. A lot of them. So from that time, the name of Kaole was born. Before that, the name of this place here was known as Pumbuji. And how they moved Pumbuji, and how they moved from Kaole to Bagamoyo. Because those clever slaves by night, they escaped from the soldiers' houses at Kaole. And the old ones, they doesn't care them, they can die. And morning when they make a account, some of the slaves are missing from the soldiers' houses. So the captain of the Arabs who was staying at the Kaole village went up to Zanzibar to see Sultan, to ask permission to build a slave house, especially to keep for the slaves. So once I get a permit, Selemani Abdallah Marahabi allowed to build a slave house in town, which you are going to see from here.
So when the wind was blowing from northeast to southwest, Arabs, they were in the Gulf, and the wind pushed them all the way up to the coast of East Africa.
Yeah.
So you can find here, along this side here, we have more than 20 ruins, which has been found, that from Somalia up to down the river in Papua New Mozambique. So it's a place where they landed. So this Kaole ruins is one of those places where the Arabs landed. So it's the use
of many of them.
No, you are not going inside.
Just so, Issa, from there we moved up to here. So this was a slave house. It was built especially to keep for the slaves. As I told you, the slaves they were staying with the soldiers there, but some of them clever ones that escaped and some others are dying. So the captain of the Arabs who was staying Kaole went up to Zanzibar to ask a permit to build this house. So this was built by Selemani Abdallah Marahabi in 1816. Yes, sir. Now we are going to see where slaves have been kept inside in original rooms.
Point of no return. That's what they call it.
Bring a car from the leader must knock here. The slaves have started walking from Kigoma over where up to Bagamoyo. And how many died on the way? Because when you get out of this road, you can't get out from this door again. You are being confused and you go in another place. That another door.
It's like point of
none. No return.
So once you get in here,
that's it.
Straight to the sea.
No.
Okay.
So one line, please.
One line.
Here, please. To take them to Zanzibar out market or to Arab market. The journey starts midnight. They blinded the eyes of the slaves not to see. Then I hold one another. They go up there. They climb from top. They go that way. Another that way. And then they come down. They get out behind the door.
Just to confuse them.
So early in the morning, early in the morning, when the sun is shining, the boat is never reaching Zanzibar, but already left Bagamoyo. It is hanging between the officer pieces from the slave's eyes, and when the slave looks through, can't see anything, only water. So they doesn't know where do they come from or where they've been taken. That's why they start the journey midnight and close the eyes of the slave. Not being sold for one slave for 60 rupees, which is 120 shillings for one slave. Because they make it auction it, depending how fit you are.
Shit, bro. Imagine Arabs, you wouldn't trade it on black men.
That is top 20 on Africa. I mean, look at the casino.
Okay, look at this list.
That's why you must have a total how many are there. Because when you get out for sold, you are not going back that way.
This door.